Howard was soon travelling the world, buying and selling the drugs that would turn him into one of Britain's biggest dope dealers.
And where was the dope coming from?
Then Turkey, Lebanon, Pakistan mainly.
Can you remember the varieties and the names of the varieties?
Yes, they were called Paki Leb. And Turkish.
We went to Morocco and we ended up going, we hired a car, went up through the mountains and to Kitama, like loads of farms. We ended up staying there for a week, totally stoned. Absolutely. We could have bought as much as we wanted, didn't like, you know. But we just stayed there absolutely oblivious, totally wrecked for a week.
Cannabis smoking seemed to be everywhere. Rock stars were forever getting busted. Most famously when Rolling Stone Mick Jagger was arrested with his then girlfriend Marianne Faithfull.
Do you remember the Marianne and Mick bust?
Oh, no, of course, yeah. I mean, but that again, I think, shows how elitist it was. Okay, the rock stars could do it and everything like that, but the postman wasn't. I mean, the plumber wasn't. It was something done by sort of glamour, the elitist set, in a sense, you know.
And I went to many dinner parties where a joint was produced, beautifully rolled, always had it, not, you know, and handed around as if it was port. After dinner, even going the same way as Portwood, you know, you're not allowed to do that, you'll do that. And I used to make a joke of it in my act sometimes, you know. To the right, you swine.
How would you characterise the attitude to marijuana smoking back in the 60s when you started smoking?
Oh, it was very daring. It was, because so few people did it. Very, very few. Only students, only people that went on the Aldermaston March did it and wore duffel coats and banned the bomb. Rainbow country,
rainbow country. But even for the trendy, turned-on middle classes, pot smoking wasn't something you told Daddy about. Sure sound
good to me. My parents would have, you know, would have died. They were very sort of strict and, you know, this was the sort of late 60s. You know, you got married and you went to school, you had a job, you got married and that was it, you know. Very different generation from now.
I don't think my parents would have known what it was about. They wouldn't have had an idea if I told them I smoked it. I didn't smoke it very much. But now it's not considered to be radical at all.
My father really disapproved of drinking. The first time I got tipsy, he was absolutely furious. So the thought of him catching me smoking dope, I mean, I would have shot myself, you know.
The stigma largely came from the drug's illegality. Caroline Coon found a release in 1967 with the aim of changing the country's draconian drug laws.
When I started release, I thought, well, I have to go to the head of Scotland Yard to tell them what we're doing. Anyway, I had the appointment to see the guy at Scotland Yard who had been kind of told to go. And I think he was expecting, of course, a hippie. And hippies were stereotyped as dirty, smelly, barefooted. So I walk into his office and he's glowering behind his desk. And I walk across the room and say, how do you do? And he leaps to his feet and says, oh, would you like a sherry? Oh, you can't smoke pot in Scotland Yard, but you can have a glass of sherry.
But the drugs were having their effects. Straight-laced post-war Britain was beginning to relax.
Pot kind of went with the way men looked, and men became very beautiful with their long hair, satin clothes, that whole kind of Jimi Hendrix's look, which had that black soul, which has that absolute strength of masculinity aligned with silkiness and smooth. I mean, just wonderful.
The sexual revolution was well underway.
Is sex better when you're stoned? Is an interesting question.
Hmm. Now, I have to be very careful about answering this one because I haven't got stoned with my man. So, no, I think it's equal.
OK, is that the diplomatic answer?
That's the diplomatic answer.
I don't know whether it's better or not. I think it just relaxes you a bit, and so it is better in that point of view. But I'd never take marijuana as an aphrodisiac. It's not Viagra. I wish it was.
Is sex better stoned?
Yes. I mean, sex, I'd put as one of the things that I enjoy doing more when I get stoned, yeah. I don't think it's an aphrodisiac particularly. I mean, if you can't get a hard on, I wouldn't advise smoking a joint particularly.
But if you do?
If you're really getting into it and you're really, really enjoying it, same with everything, then yeah, absolutely fantastic. Like, you can feel that, you know, the kiss on your arms and, you know, the kiss on your neck more and everything. So, yeah. So sometimes, yeah, it would be loads better. Other times, like, get off me.
By the mid-70s, the dope-fueled hippie dream was dying. And it wasn't hard to see why.
All the leaves around and the sky is grey.
I think one of the fascinating things to me about cannabis is thinking about deep questions about the nature of self. Who am I? What's the point of being alive? Do I have free will? And it really seems to help with those questions. I feel different. I feel perhaps more, at the best, more part of the world and less cut off from it, less trapped inside here in the illusion of being a self, more able to realise that I'm... This is all an interconnected universe. I must be part of this thing. The way that it encourages that.
Whereas hippies were peace and love, the punks were hate and war. And part of their iconic mood was not to use that dreadful drugs that the hippies used, was to use a much more kind of assertive drug, which would, and I don't like to tell tales, but as in my experience, the punk groups were using more likely to use speed, more likely to use pills. Than they were to smoke pot as their front. But, you know, as we know what we actually do in our front rooms, of course there was a lot of pot smoking amongst punks as well.
We knew of the background, we knew that it came, you know, we remember seeing things on TV and stuff about hippies and communes and the swinging 60s and everyone getting really high, man, and it all being really cool. But that wasn't where we were at. That was then. It's completely different to what we were in the 80s. We were teenagers. We were like the mass rebellion. It was the 80s where it was just like spin fast, wild colours, this, that and the other. And we were just teenagers, so we just tried everything and anything, I suppose.
Howard Marks spent 8 years in jail for his dope dealing. By the time he was released in the mid-1990s, the world of dope smoking had changed forever.
Then it was a massive change.
Could you explain what that change?
The change, again, is mainly in that it suddenly seemed to be the case that most working class people smoked dope, or most of the ones that I ran into anyway. There didn't seem to be suddenly a profession that didn't smoke dope. I mean, in the 60s and the 70s, to some extent, it was either sort of students, lawyers, you know, judges, yeah, middle-class people. Now it is everyone.
How widespread would you say that dope smoking is amongst the people that you know?
Very widespread. Very widespread, really. I mean, we all go back to people's houses. You know, like on the weekend, we'll go back and have a sesh, take some beers, and we all smoke. All of us.
So, I mean, what type of age group would that be?
40s right up to 60s.
K Kath and Howard aren't just imagining things, it's true. Cannabis use in Britain has doubled over the last 10 years. 10 million people admit to having occasionally smoked and inhaled. Over 3 million are regular puffers.
There's an awful lot of money involved in this industry. It's expanded dramatically, whereby you used to just get, say, your hippies and your bikers, etc., that used to smoke a lot of cannabis. Now it's gone all the way through society.
Is it a market that's filled?
It's still expanding. I've watched this market grow over the past, say, 5 years. It seems to double every year. And that's the way it's still going. It's not slowing down.
Well, you know, I go to dinner parties, I suppose, trendy dinner parties, where spliffs, I think, are the least part of it. If you would smoke a spliff, they say, oh, she's a bit of an old flower power person. I mean, they're taking cocaine. I mean, that's much more handing around the mirror with the lines after the tiramisu is what one does at those kind of dinner parties.
The other big thing that's changed is the quality and strength of the dope that people are now smoking.
The standard dope you buy in the street now is different from the standard dope that one bought in the street in the 60s. Essentially, the hash is a lot worse and weaker, and the marijuana is a lot better and stronger.
The hashish Howard's referring to is commonly known as soap bar. Over 2 tons of this noxious formula is smoked in Britain every week.
About half of the cannabis market, according to research in Britain, is what's called formula. It's Moroccan soap bar cannabis, a very low grade of hashish, produced particularly for Britain and some other countries in Morocco. But what happens to it on the way to Britain, in Spain and Holland and sometimes in Britain, is it's ground down. You can get 100 kilos of cannabis, grind it all down in a skip, add 100 kilos of adulterants, re-block it up to make it look like cannabis resin again, and that is what is known as formula.
Soap bar's so infamous, spoof rap combo GLC even wrote a song about it.
Oh, soap bar comes from fucking Holland. They make it out of oil and tyres and pollen. Diesel, mirror bar, flat press too. These are types of soap bar available to you. These little bits of plastic you find inside, you can use those as a quality guide. The standard of soap bar that you are smoking, the more bits of plastic means the better the token.
Have you ever heard of soap bar?
Oh, wouldn't touch it with a barge pole.
Why?
And I would go round the schools personally and tell the children not to touch it, because it's filled with all kinds of rubbish. There's liquid, there's only about 5% of what's in a soap bar is cannabis.
What's the rest of it?
Straw, liquid plastic, boot polish, hay, any old rubbish they can put in to build it up and bulk it out. And it's really dangerous because you inhale that and it goes into your lungs. Your lungs are not going to be very healthy for very long.
Things like old engine oil are often found, for instance, in formula cannabis.
Engine oil from cars
and lorries and so on. Yeah, and this can be used in the mix when cannabis is reconstituted into formula to make more money.
What, oil that's been in cars?
Yes, used engine oil has turned up in some of these, and we know that's carcinogenic for start off. We have no idea what smoking vinyl does to people because nobody ever expected anyone to smoke it. So I don't think much research has been done on what smoking vinyl and dog shit does to people.
You can kind of guess though, can't you?
Yeah, I can imagine it will absolutely destroy their health over the long term if they keep doing it.
No one's complaining. I mean, the criminals who buy the stuff from the Moroccans, they don't even smoke it. They take it. The people in the streets in the country buy it. So it'll continue to happen until people stop buying it. Because it is shite, and they should stop buying it.
I think everybody ought to come on and go with me. Let's go get some.
Many people have taken Howard and Pat's advice and turned their backs on the dreaded soap bar. But unfortunately for them, the alternative, high-grade marijuana, has brought its own problems too.